There are two types of the mycosis, superficial and the deep mycosis, and I will be covering the deep mycosis. Deep mycosis consists of the two again entities, that is systemic mycosis and the opportunistic mycosis. I will be covering the systemic mycosis. Myself, Dr. Anagha Pinnikku, Professor, Department of Microbiology. So these systemic mycosis, these are actually causative agents, are the true fungal agents, and they have in the virulence, and so they can cause the infections in the healthy individuals. They cause the infection with the severe varying severity and disseminated to the other parts through the hematogenous route also. They primarily involve the respiratory system, and later on they may involve the internal organs. Infection occurs primarily from the inhalation or the airborne route, and mainly the infective, these are the conidia. The more than 95% of the infections of these causative agents, they are self-limiting and asymptomatic, and rest are the symptomatic and then disseminate through the hematogenous route. Most of these infections, these are caused by the trimorphic fungi, and so we are here covering the 24 causative agents which are classified as a dimorphic fungi and causes the systemic mycosis in the healthy and the immunocompetent individuals. Other systemic infections which I told you, they can be seen in the immunocompromised patients, and these are called as opportunistic mycotic infections. That will be covered in the separate lecture. So what are these dimorphic fungi? So these are the fungus or fungi which exist in the two forms, filaments as well as the yeast form. So generally at 25 degree centigrade in the soil, they exist as filaments, and at 37 degree centigrade in host tissue, they exist as yeast cells. So the least of the systemic mycotic infections, causative agents, that can be Histoplasma capsulatum, Blastomyces dermatitis, Paracoccidioides brazilensis, Coccidioides immitis, and the just enlisting the dimorphic fungi, I have given the name, that is Penicillium marnefi, which is actually opportunistic agent, and the Sporothrix, which you have already covered in the subcutaneous infection. So to see just the outline the life cycle of any dimorphic fungi, it exists in the two forms. So yeast form, and the mold form or the filamentous form. Yeast form, these actually entered in the host cells and germinate in the yeast cells, and then they grow and multiplies, and then they are given out, and in the soil they develop as the filamentous form and given out as the spores, and that life cycle is continued. So the first causative agent we will discuss today, it is histoplasmosis. The name of the infection is the histoplasmosis, and the causative agent is the Histoplasma capsulatum. So all these four causative agents or the four diseases, they are actually endemic in the various parts of the world, and so they are constantly present in those areas only. The Histoplasmosis capsulatum, this is actually intracellular infection of the RES system, that is a reticular endothelial system, and this is endemic in the parts of the United States of America. This is also called as a Darling's disease, as it was first described by the Samuel Darling in 1905. He thought the causative agent to be like a protozoan agent like Leishmania donovani, and he named it as a Histoplasma capsulatum. Histio meaning the histiocytes, as it was intracellular, and plasma meaning resembling with the plasmodium species. This agent is present normally, as it is a soil saprophyte. It is present in soil, in rotting trees, in fecal matter of the chicken, bats and the other birds. So where they have a high nitrogen content for the growth and development. I told you this is actually endemic diseases and these are commonly distributed in specific areas. So the histoplasmosis is very common in the central and eastern states of the United States of America. Histoplasma capsulatum, so this is just to enlighten the life cycle. You can see here the trees and involvement of the various birds, and this filamentous forms, and these are inhaled by the human being. So how the pathogenesis occurs? The inhalation of the conidia or the mycelial fragments will lead take the lead to the lungs, and then in the alveolar macrophages they are converted into the yeast. They causes a localized granulomatous inflammation in the lungs, and they may cause the caseation, granulomas with the caseation or without the caseation, or may disseminate to the various other parts of the reticular endothelium system or the lymphatic system. So it involves the all phagocytic cells which are involved in the reticular endothelial system. Patient clinical features, they mainly resemble as tuberculosis, and sometimes mainly they are asymptomatic. As I told you, the various infections we are discussing today, mostly they are 95% they are asymptomatic. But there are various clinical types we can see, that is pulmonary type, cutaneous and the mucocutaneous type, and the disseminated histoplasmosis, which is commonly seen in children below 2 years of the adolescence. Apart from this, disseminated histoplasmosis can be seen in the patients with the HIV, and all of you know that is one of the criteria to decide the stages. So how to go for the laboratory diagnosis of such infection? The specimens which we collect, with that can be respiratory specimens, especially the sputum and the bronchoalveolar lavage. And other samples we can take, it is a bone marrow, lymph node biopsy, scrapings from the lesions if there is a cutaneous or the mucocutaneous lesions, and also the peripheral blood we can take. So peripheral blood can be examined with the staining technique, GIMSA or the right stains we can do, and here we can see the small oval yeast cells which are around 2 to 4 micron and within the mononuclear or the polynuclear cells. So that can be various monocytes or the macrophages. We can also detect this organism with the fluorescent antibody technique. So these are the special yeast cells which we can see. These are very small, 2 to 4, and these are intracellular part. So fungal culture, as I told you, this is a dimorphic fungi. So in host tissues, it is at 37 degrees centigrade, it is in the yeast cell form. But otherwise, at room temperature or in the laboratory, when we grow at 25 degrees centigrade, it is in filamentous form. So here, it forms the white colony mycelium, and with the LPCB technique, leptophenol cotton blue staining technique, we can see the structure with the spores, and this can be a mycelial element we can see, and especially the microconidia with tuberculate appearance can be seen. So this type of the growth you can see, remember here 37 degrees centigrade, that is a yeasty growth you can see. For all the four positive agents we are discussing today, the yeasty growth will be at 37 degrees centigrade, and at 25 degrees centigrade it will be cottony mycelium like. So these are the few peaks of the mycelium growth, which shows the tuberculate macrocomedia, and this is the hyphal element which we can see. So such type of the growth we can see in the lab in the culture media at 25 degrees centigrade. We can go for the immunodiagnosis also. Histoplasmin screen test. This is an intradermal test with 0.1 ml histoplasmin antigen, which is injected as like tuberculin testing, and we see here the delayed hypersensitivity, that is a DTH response. The latex agglutination test can be done to diagnose the antibodies, to see the titer of the antibody, and titer around 1 to 32 or the higher, or 4-fold rise in the titer of antibodies taken as a significant. There are also tests which detect the histoplasma antigen also with various immunoassays, and they have a greater specificity and can be used in the immunocompromised patients. For the histoplasmosis, the drug of choice is the amphotericin B when the infection is disseminated. Otherwise, oral itraconazole can be given. And for preventing, regular cleaning of the farm building and the chicken houses is necessary. The second causative agent for the cystic mycosis is a blastomycosis, and the disease is called as a blastomycosis. The disease is also named as the Gilchrist disease or the Chicago disease due to its endemicity in the North America. It is also known as a North American blastomycosis. This is caused by the inhalation of the spores of the Blastomyces dermatitis. As the name is dermatitis, it has the symptoms of the skin also. It causes suppurative and the granulomatous infection, and I told you it is in the commonly seen in the North America, or it is endemic in the North America. Clinical features: it resembles again tuberculosis or the histoplasmosis, as it has a clinical types like pulmonary cutaneous, which is very commonest form, and the lesions are seen over the exposed parts of the face, neck and the hands. Disseminated type: this form can be seen in the form of the multiple abscesses in different parts like bones, genitourinary system and also in the breast. Laboratory diagnosis: we can go with the specimen, sputum specimen, bronchoalveolar lavage, biopsy, or pus or the abscesses from the cutaneous lesions, or also urine sample can be collected. The direct examination, we can go for the KOH mount if the skin sweating or the biopsy pus lesions are there. Wet mount can be done, KOH mount, or also we can go for the calcifluor white stain. Here we can see the thick walled multinucleate giant yeast cells. So remember, these are the broad-based yeast cells as compared to the histoplasma cells. These are having quite large size, and the broad base is a very significant one. So these are budding yeast cells which are shown in the picture. The fungal culture can be done on the media. We recommend Sabros Dextrose on our medium for the fungus, and here it shows the slow growth. In the 2 to 4 weeks growth can come. It shows again the cottony mycelium growth, and at 37 degrees centigrade it can show the yeast cells, but at 25 degrees centigrade it shows the branch septate hyphae with conidia measuring 2 to 10 and located on the terminal, short terminal of the lateral branches. So you can see in the picture, this is the septate hyphae, and you can see the microchlamydia in this picture. The same picture, type of the fluorescence. Diagnosis can be made by using the immunodeficient techniques also, and also with the immunoassays, different immunoassays, that is the EIA or the radioimmunoassay. And also the skin testing can be done using the blastomycin antigen. Treatment for this disease is with the azole reagent, whether ketoconazole or the itraconazole. And in disseminated infections, it is a and fluorescein B, which is used. The third causative agent in the systemic mycosis, and the disease is known as a coccidioidal mycosis. The agent is respiratory and the highly infectious of all fungal. We are saying it is fungal pathogen. It is most virulent and the highly infectious, but it is not so much contagious. This fungus is also present in the soil and also in the rodents. The infection with the or sometimes if there is a reactivation of the latent infection. So this fungus is endemic in the southwestern part of the USA. The coccidioides immitis, this is a fungus which exists in the Orthopomidia form and also in the spirulina form. So you can see here, this is a routine saprophytic life cycle, and here it is a parasitic life cycle where it enters in the human cell. So you can see here, this is the endospore, and these endospores are contained with the spirules. These are going to be matured, and after few days it is again infecting the human being, and after this life cycle is continued. So this is a very virulent fungal pathogen and also the infectious one. The disease caused by the coccidioidal mycosis is also known as valley fever or the desert rheumatism. Only 1% of these persons will disseminate this. Also, it can infect the central nervous system, causing the meningitis. Specimens we can collect for this agent, these are sputum, gastric contents also can be collected, cerebrospinal fluid, and also the exudate or the pus if the abscesses are there. In diameter. This tissue can be stained with the various staining tissue stains, especially the hematoxylin, then periodic acid scoffs, and also the Gomery's methanol silver stain. It is slightly different from the other dimorphic fungi as a mold at 25 and 37 degrees centigrade under standard condition. So it can choose any way mold or the yeast form at 25 and also at 37 degrees centigrade. The growth appears in 3 to 5 days at 25 degrees centigrade, and when we do the lactophenol cotton blue staining, the culture shows the branching siphonate hyphae and chains of thick walled rectangular orthoconidia. Can see here some empty cells are also there. So the alternate empty cells and the orthoconidia are there, and they are fragmented and the air, and it causes the airborne infection. Now this LPC. This is a very infectious agent, fungal agent, and so it is advised to do the work with this. So these are especially made for such type of the organism, which can be very infectious to the hand. As you know, our parasitic cabinet and airways are controlled. Immunodiagnosis for this agent can be made with the skin testing. Here the intradermal inoculation of the coccidioid. If it is the induration is more than 5 mm in 24 hours. In the serological diagnosis disease, if it is a rapidly progressive disease, we can start with the amphotericin B, and if it is a chronic and mild to moderate, we can start with the azoxystrobin or the next systemic disease is a mycosis. This can be acute, chronic, or the granulomatous infection in the lungs. American. So it is known as the South Asian. It can have been with acute, chronic, latent, and also involvement. This agent the collecting various symptoms in the primary pus and crust from the granulomatous lesions, and also taken from the lymph nodes or the various internal tissues. We can go for the KOH white blood where we can see the round refractive yeast which is having the 2 to 10 micron size with the multiple blooding, budding, and this form we can see in the tissues also. So this such type of the multiple budding we can see, and this is a very pathognomonic sign of this agent. We can grow this organism in Sabrols, Dextrose agar, brain heart infusion agar, and also on the blood agar. 25 degrees centigrade, colonies are white to tan in color with a yellowish brown on the reverse side. And if we make the LPCB, that is lactophenol cotton blue, wet mount, we can see mycelia bearing conidia and numerous intercalary chlamydospores. At 37 degrees centigrade, the fungal growth will be off white to cream and rough to pasty in the appearance, and the lactophenol cotton blue will show the spherical mother cell surrounded by the multiple and the causative agent is the parabrasilensis. So such type of the growth we can see. This is another picture showing the growth. So treatment, if person B with the advice, so this is to revise. This is the histoplasma capsule. So these are very small. That is also his second. Blastomyces dermatitis, yeast cells which are broad-based one, and the yeast cells are quite large having the size of the 20 microns. And third, this is coccidioid which shows the spherules and the endospores. And this is, remember, this is a very virulent fungal pathogen and has to be handled in the biosafety cabinet 3. With the analysis, which shows the typical or the pilot's wheel appearance in the yeast form. So all these are the endemic diseases, and rarely the cases are found in the India. The Indian cases are also may have the history or travel history. There is a various reports of the histoplasma cases in the India. But for other cases, we don't have report of those. So thank you. We will be continuing with the opportunistic mycosis and the medical mycology. Thank you.